Good morning to all of you. Good morning, Aris. Good morning, Alex. Good morning, Claude. Good morning to all of you. Kostas, how are you? So, I mean, first of all, thank you for attending at our 12 user meeting. Once again, this will be the second meeting, which is on a remote basis, and we hope that this will be the last one. Let's hope that actually the situation with vaccination will improve and we will be in a condition to meet in person from the next year. The meeting on this year is organized fundamentally on the news that we are going to, that as you know, we already introduced, you know, that we got the CE mark either on IRIS2 and on CIPTA2. So we will basically mainly focus this meeting on what we call now the 4D suite, which is basically the new generation, which will soon replace the IV suite. The meeting will be organized in this way. I will provide you an introduction basically on the news of the 4D suite. And then there will be a question and answer. There are already some questions which were introduced by some of you. Of course, we will be open to answer to any further question that will come out during the meeting. After this session, we will have a web demo of the entire 4D suite. So we will basically acquire a couple of patients with a live process, introducing the medical record, acquiring Precisio, planning the CIPTA, and then executing the surgery with IRIS2. And finally, for whoever of you that will be interested to have a virtual experience on the CIPTA2, I mean, I want just to anticipate that CIPTA2 in the 4D suite, it's not just the software to plan the ablation, but is really, it's the center of the entire system. The platform became really software-centric with the CIPTA2. And then finally, again, as I said, whoever would like to have an experience, a virtual experience on CIPTA2, we will set three or four rooms in order to provide you such an experience. But let me share my screen to start basically the presentation. Do you see my screen?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Since the beginning. Well, as I told you, for this suite, which are, of course, what we do here, we exploit the experience of the IV suite in the last 15 years. And which one is the main aim of the 4D suite? To provide full remote control operation. Why this? To ensure performance optimization, intraoperative risk minimization, and overall surgical outcome standardization. But ideally, we want to get it independently from the physical location of the surgery, thanks to the remote control that we will also have on IRIS2. At the end, we may say that we want to provide you full remote control of the entire process, which starts from the screening to the diagnosis to the treatment, finally to the follow-up. This process was named the SDTF process, and this was presented to the European Commission as basically an ensemble of full automation of the processes. So again, the main difference in between the IV suite and the 4D suite is that the 4D suite is really a software-centric technology. CIPTA Web became the center of our world and interacts basically with a web-based connection with all of the device. In other words, you may basically just enter in CIPTA wherever you are, and you can look at the data or interact with Precisio, with P-Matrix, with IRIS2, also interact with iVerify, which at the end of the day became a web library connecting all of the data in an anonymous form. That's basically now. I will not discuss anything about p-matrix because we are all well aware about the feature of p-matrix. So my presentation will be mainly addressed to some news that are related to Precisio 2, but overall it will be dedicated to SIPTA 2 and IRES 2. Precisio 2, you know, some of you, they are already familiar with this device, but there are several guys that still do not know which are the main feature of Precisio 2. Precisio 2 basically is conceived to provide full automated certification of the acquired data for surgical purposes. So Precisio 2 basically is designed in order to minimize basically all of the subjective risks and overall to provide basically a dedicated analysis of the epithelium, because of course, after so many years of experience of transepithelial surgery with C10, we basically came to the point that was of a fundamental importance to really control the contribute of the epithelium. In order to do this, Precisio basically uses a patented blue basin slit, 30 micron thickness, why a laser slit? Because we want to negate divergency, because we want to have a constant thickness along the entire optical path, the way that the cross-section of the slit on the apex of the cornea is exactly equal to the cross-section on the limbus, thus increasing lateral resolution of a factor equal to 5. Blue, why blue, 450? Because all of us, we know that the epithelium has high scattering in the blue. And if you really want to detect the separation line between epithelium and stroma, it's necessary to emphasize such a contrast. But another one important feature which differentiates Precisio by any OCT is the quality of light that we analyze. We do not analyze as an OCT different of density of media, because in such a case, we would have not been able to make distinction between lacrimal film and epithelium. While on the contrary, we want to know exactly for surgical purposes, the effective profile of the epithelium, and also we want to register it. So for this reason, we use the scattering. Why the scattering? Because liquids do not provide scattering. We can provide you, whoever of you would like to get it, we can provide you a video where we may show you that one patient, even if he puts a few drops of a quite heavy lacrimal film, the epithelial maps, the differential maps, does not change at all. Another fundamental feature of Precisio to grant such level of accuracy is the eye tracker. Precisio implements exactly the same eye tracker of IRES 2 to compensate all of the 6 degrees of freedom, which means the 3 translation, the 3 rotation, because basically the acquisition, even if it, as you may see from this video, if it takes only 1 second, the eye moves, and we need to compensate such a movement for the 1 million points that we detect. Last but not least is the full automation. You know that all of our competitors, when they claim to customize the ablation, they generally require you surgeons to select which one image to use to customize the ablation among a bunch of images selected. We basically, as you see, we think that this is not the appropriate way. We think that due to the reason that we are making a permanent modification of the cornea, we need to certify this acquisition by performing a differential analysis automated, and only if the differential analysis is satisfied, then the export function should be allowed. And this is the way that basically you may control the auto Precisio, even if you may be at 300 kilometer distance from the device. Now, about elevation maps, on top, of course, of the very familiar anterior and posterior, Precisio provides stromal surface. Stromal surface are generally speaking more basically irregular than the anterior due to the contribute, of course, of the epithelium. But let me tell you also something that is brand new in Precisio, which is the introduction of the gradient maps. What is a gradient map? Gradient means that we are looking at the change of the slope of the cornea with respect to the best fit sphere. So a normal cornea would like, of course, if it is very similar to a sphere, would like to have basically a gradient close to zero. Why gradient map may be useful? Because we look how much the slope change. And here, for example, we have an ectasia, and we may see clearly that looking at the change of the slope, we may find the perimeter of the ectasia, and as a consequence, define the exact region of the cornea where to make cross-linking, avoiding to make cross-linking up to 9, 10 millimeter in order basically to be as less invasive as possible. Regarding thickness map, of course, on total tachymetry, we have basically the introduction of the epithelial maps. What I would like to emphasize about our epithelial maps is that they are repeatable below basically 3 micron, but overall, those are registered epithelial maps because we want to know exactly that specific point, how much is the epithelium, not just have a generic map. The map are basically up to 10 millimeters, and here we may clearly see that in a regular case, generally speaking, the epithelium is very regular, typically slightly thinner on the temporal superior, but we may see that with the increase of the ectasia, we may see how much basically the thickness changes, reducing on the mountain in order to mitigate basically the aberration of the stromal. Thus, we may also calculate what we call as gradient thickness map. The gradient thickness map are useful exactly to basically define how much is irregular the thickness of our cornea. Generally, all of us, basically, we are familiar with the concept that the cornea are thinner in the center and in the periphery. So I would say that a thickness, a gradient of 20 micrometer, the gradient here, what is this? Is the difference in thickness between two points divided by the distance between the two points. And what we may see, for example, is that if we look at the gradient of the epithelium in a normal case, as you may see, is almost zero, and look at how basically the gradient increase at the increase of the ectasia. So this provides us a clear indication that the epithelium changes stratification in order to compensate the stroma. But I would like to keep your attention on the stromal gradient. Why stromal gradient are very important? Because the stromal gradient, they measure the slippage of the stromal fiber due basically to the lack of the cross-linking between the stromal fibers. So the higher the gradient of the stroma, the higher basically the highest level of the ectasia. So at the end of the day, we may correlate as a consequence the amount of energy to be irrigated in a customized way to again just provide energy where needed, still with the aim to basically minimize the invasiveness of the cross-linking procedure. So you will see later on in SIPTA how we customize basically the release of the energy with SIPTA 2. Anterior chamber, I will not take too much time. The reason for the anterior chamber is just to correlate the ideal pupil with the refractive zone. Precisio also detect with a very accurate way the angle K, and we will see in SIPTA how we can eventually compensate an angle K, a first order correction. But let me now be focused on the very important, basically, innovation, which is some between Precisio and SIPTA, the introduction of very dedicated ray tracing maps. Why ray tracing maps are important? Because all of us, we know, we are familiar with axial tangential maps, but those are pure speculation. They are indicative representation of the power of the cornea. If we really want to look at the real power, we need to perform a ray tracing of a bunch of light or beam light parallel to the visual axis, which then will be retracted by the anterior cornea, by the posterior cornea, by the lens, till when you will meet on the retinal plane thus creating a point spread function. Of course, the shorter, the closer the point spread function, the better the quality of the vision, while the centroid of the point spread function, which is the best focusing point, will provide us an indication of the tilt that we have with respect to the system axis. But let's look here. How we can use this ray tracing? Well, first of all, if we basically look, we stop here, we may consider which one is the total corneal ray tracing. And if we subtract from the total corneal the anterior, which as you see is always more irregular than the total, by difference, we know which one is the true refractive power contribute of the posterior shape. Look at here the chromatic contribution of this cone. Same logic we may apply for the epithelium. So in other words, we may subtract from the stromal power the anterior power, and finally to get the true epithelium, the true contribute of the epithelium from a refractive point of view. So again, if we look at ray tracing maps, we may see, for example, that the anterior is always basically more irregular than the total due to the contribution of the posterior, and the stromal is worse than the anterior because the epithelium mitigates irregularity of the stroma. Look, this is a normal case with a very regular epithelial refractive map, and at the increase of the ectasia, we see how the chromatic contribute of the epithelium is useful in order to reduce basically the aberration of the anterior shape. Also for the refractive map, we may create gradient refractive. And again, gradient refractive is difference of power between two points divided by the distance. Why this may be useful? Because as you know, when we need also to customize the connecting zone, because we need to make it larger where the angle is worse, and overall we want to provide a constant gradient of power, because basically we want to avoid the risk of glare or halos. And look at here, this is a very regular case, and you see in a progressive way how the stromal gradient became worse and how it's important as a consequence to customize basically the connecting zone. So Precisio became the fundamental tool to support really the job of SIPTA. Another one point of Precisio is the possibility to provide an automatic evaluation of the irregularities of the cornea. How we can do this? All of us, we are familiar with HOA, high order of aberration, but all of us, we know that the HOA are strongly dependent by the pupil size. While once we want to modify basically the cornea, we need to rely on an objective parameter. And this is the reason why we introduced the corneal morphological irregularity index. What is this? It's how many micron, the sum of micron, which the cornea is different with respect to the toroid surface. Why the toroid? Because we want only to consider the high order of aberration. So looking at the difference of E plus E minus, this gives us an indication of the job that the laser has to do. So the amount of tissue needed to be corrected, the exact amount of tissues needed to be erased in order to basically eliminate high order of aberration. This finally create three families. On the left, the largest irregular disorder, NID. And those are the cases which show very low corneal morphological irregularities. On the contrary, if we see, looking at this parameter, that we have relevant aberration, we know that we are in presence of a complex case, of a therapeutic case. And then we introduced the capability by making an analysis. You see here, we analyze, because it's important in the therapeutic case to make a distinction in between the stable cases where we can just remove tissues with respect to the ectatic case, where we need not only to remove, but also to stabilize the cornea, so to cross-link together. And how precise you can do this? Because it analyzes, once we found that there is a relevant amount of corneal morphological index of aberration, Precisio looks for the location of the irregularity of the mountains and consider if the minimum thickness is in the same area. Of course, if this is in the same area, this will be classified as an AID, ictatic irregular disorder. On the contrary, it will be a stable cases. So at the end of the day, Precisio provides automatically, basically, a classification in between these three families. Each acquisition that will be provided by such classification. And again, just the ectatic will be automatically planned by the SIPTA software together with a cross-linking plan, which may be, of course, standard, but overall, it will be also customized according with the indication that I will shortly provide you. Of course, we also detect opacity. And finally, Precisio provides the capability to make a clinical follow-up to evaluate the progression of a pathology. So comparing two exams at a different date provides the capability to make surgical outcome, meaning comparison in between the expected and the achieved results in order to evaluate the job of the laser, but also the healing of the cornea. And finally, the surgical follow-up to compare basically post-op, for example, at 1 month, at 1 year, in order to look at the stability of the treatment. Finally, the last innovation in Precisio 2 is the introduction based on the ray tracing of a convolution technique, which allow us basically to simulate how basically the patient, the vision will be according with the size of the point spread function. This is a convolution process, which it's at the end of the day, a ray tracing, an opposite ray tracing starting from the retinal plane. Now let's come to the center of the world, to the center of the 4D suite, which is again is the SIPTA2. The SIPTA2, as I told you, I mean, of course, is a planning software, but overall is a control tool. We will see how we can use SIPTA to introduce the medical record of the patient, to control Precisio, to deliver to the laser, and finally also to control and verify. And again, SIPTA, as you know, basically through the ray tracing uses morphological data, refractive data, and pupillometric data with the aim of optimized quality of vision, but also to be as less invasive as possible. So finally, the principle of SIPTA, ablate only where needed. Do not waste tissue. Second point, in order to do this, minimize the ablation, basically. So define the ideal shape to remove only the tissue where needed. Minimize the ablation, avoiding to go out of the ideal pupil, and overall provide a stability of the ablation, customizing the connecting zone in order to allow an homogeneous regrowth of the epithelium, but as well also avoid risk of glare. So finally, we may define the ideal shape of Precisio as a composition of a customized refractive zone and a customized connecting zone, where the connecting zone has the main function to be a bridge in between the new ideal shape and the untouched cornea. So finally, refractive zone, we will see, is defined by this patented ray tracing algorithm, while the connecting zone is fundamentally based, again, with support of the gradient maps to define a constant gradient of curvature along the entire connecting zone. But now, in order to basically improve vision and also be as less invasive, the importance of the posterior shape and how we can basically exploit its contribution. We clearly see that ectasia is even stronger, and we all know that it is even stronger in the posterior. We see here basically how much, for example, in a case like this, we are looking that the aberration of the posterior in an advanced cone like this may reach up even to 7 diopter of irregular refractive compound. Now, if we were going to basically make a total remodeling, this is the deformation on the anterior shape. If we make a complete regularization of the anterior shape, removing completely the cone, we see that we make an overcorrection of our treatment because basically we are negating the comatic effect of the posterior shape. So what we can do, we can make a very sophisticated point by point analysis to have all of the point matching the ideal focusing point, and finally to build the ideal shape, which will keep some comatic effect, which is needed to compensate for the posterior. So at the end of the day, you see that we remove less tissue, but increase also the quality of vision. While the connecting, as I told you, must be designed to provide a constant gradient, because the constant gradient minimizes the risk of glare or halos, while the constant slope facilitates the homogeneous regrowth of the epithelium in radial direction. Here we have, for example, we may see the refractive contribution and the difference in refractive contribution of the posterior shape, and we may compare head by head, basically, an ectasia. It's not a very strong ectasia, but it's important also to see in a case like this, with basically a basic with ruler. Let's look at the basically panorama of this irregular case. We may see regular anterior and posterior shape. We may see that the ray tracing of the anterior show an astigmatism, but regular astigmatism. Very minor astigmatism on posterior shape from a refractive point of view, and we see that the epithelium is very, very normal, okay? And as a consequence, the point spread function is very limited, very narrow, and the pre-op with the eyeglasses is good. If we plan now the comparison, like if we were completely ignoring the posterior shape with respect to compare the total shape, we see that the difference in the ablation are really minor, okay? Really minor because again, the contribute of the posterior is minor. Even the refractive difference in between the ablation and the total refraction is very minor. And at the end of the day, also if we look at expected quality of vision post-ops, the two are extremely similar. So the truly advantage of the contribution of the posterior is really in the ectatic case. Now look at here. The posterior, very bulging. If we look the anterior, look the comatic effect, but you see comparing the anterior with the total cornea, we see how the posterior mitigate the contribution of the anterior due to this again comatic effect of about, as you may see, 7 diopter. And even the epithelium you see provide with respect to the stroma a comatic compensation. This is the quality of vision pre-op of such a patient. We see that there is a strong angle K induced by the brain of the patient to compensate for such tilting, and also the quality of vision quite distorted. Now, look at here. If we remove completely the cone on the anterior, we are going to remove around 73 micron, while if we take care of the posterior, our ablation is much less. In differential analysis, we are saving 15 micron in a case like this. But overall, what is important is that we are saving this 15 micron in the thinness point of the cornea. And this is again the difference in refractive contribution in between the total cornea, which clearly emphasizes that here, if we were going to make an anterior remodeling, we are going to keep a comatic effect of over 2 diopters due to the contribution of the posterior shape. And again, the quality of vision in comparison in between the two, you see that, of course, even if we remove the total cone, there is an improvement, but we see that there is still a comatic effect in the opposite direction. The epithelial ablation now. I mean, actually, Precisio, with this capability to provide high level accuracy epithelium, may allow to customize also the epithelium. So, in other words, we may divide the volume of ablation in between the stromal ablation and the epithelial ablation in order to do what? To basically deliver with the right ablation rate, the stroma, and right ablation rate for the epithelium. On top of this, we may have also a side advantage. If in case, for example, the customized epithelium is generally thinner than the standard ablation profile, we may also save, you see, the blue region is the area where we can now introduce the exact ablation rate in the stroma, which before with the standard ablation was considered just as a unique. But on top of this, in case the epithelium is thinner, the real epithelium, we also save tissue. And this may be a case of some, for example, ectatic case, some keratoconus. On the contrary, if the epithelium would have been thicker than the standard, well, in such a case, we will be happy to remove it because, on the contrary, we would have been getting a reduction of the refractive zone. Here we see the differences in between basically two cases again. We may see that in the first case, of course, the epithelium is quite regular. And the differences, the normal case, there are some differences, but it's really minor, minor differences. On the contrary, if we look at the ectatic case, we see that the epithelium has a quite relevant stratification. And we see that in such a case, the stromal ablation is now, in this case, around 80 micron thickness. Why this? Because this will be saved on the epithelium point of view. So here, the main difference will be in such a case that this 7 micron, 7 to 8 micron, will be delivered with the appropriate ablation rate of the stroma. Few words on the first order. SIPTA2 allows now the correction also of the first order. And the correction of this first order may be addressed in order to compensate strabismus. In such a case, which one is the hypothesis? We, for example, in such a case, we are requiring a correction of the angle K of 1.3 degrees. And this will be the prismatic ablation that will be executed. And what we want to get? We want to get at the end of the day, of course, assuming that the retina of this patient is in a good condition, if we induce a prismatic lens, and this prismatic lens applied on the lens is much more accurate than a prismatic lens on the eyeglasses, automatically will provide a contrarotation, the prismatic ablation that we do here, we provide a contrarotation which will reduce the angle of the desired amount. Same logic may be applied, but with a different mechanism, may be applied in case we have basically a macular degeneration. Here we are just basically representing a region of the retina, which basically is affected by, it's let's say, just damaged for a moment. So what we may say, we would like now in such a case to deliver the best focusing point out of such region. How we can do this? Again, introducing basically an offset. Here we may say, for example, that this region is about 100 micron. Of course, here we will need either a microperimetry or an OCT in order to define such a distance. But once this distance is defined, we will provide the ablation to compensate for such a distance. And in such case, due to the reason that this is just an expectation, we hope to have as many as you want to start a clinical trial, but our expectation will be that if we will address the best focusing point in the safest region of the retina, there will be no reason why the brain should require a rotation of the eye. And so we do expect to induce this prismatic effect onto the cornea in order to improve the quality of vision of such a patient. I will finish the presentation, and then there will be the question and answers. And of course, on top of the question and answers that you already delivered us, which you will get your answers, it will be open, of course, to any further question you wish. A few information now on the how SICTA can customize the cross-linking. Look at here how much the stromal gradient modifies. This is an intermediate ectasia, and this is an advanced. Look at the gradient of the stroma, how is worse here with respect to here. So of course, it's quite evident that here we need to deliver more energy to create more robust connection than here. And as a consequence, what SIPTA does, basically SIPTA creates a customized ablation map, delivering high energy where more needed and decreasing to the periphery. So at the end of the day, we never go up to 10 millimeters. Of course, we could go up to 10 millimeters if the gradient requires, but generally the diameter of the zone is defined, as I told you, by the slope gradient, while the stromal gradient defines how much energy change from the center to the periphery in order with the final purpose to again deliver as many as low energy as possible, but getting always the stability of the cornea. And again, in order to do this, we need to rely from one side on the quality of acquisition of the gradient stroma by Precisio 2, but same time, having the laser the capability to really customize the cross-linking, but also to have a very powerful light tracker in order to follow the movement of the patient during the cross-linking, because now this is not a standard cross-linking, it's customized, and we want to be sure that we are going to deliver the cross-linking exactly where needed. I will finish with a few information on the new IRIS. We will see later on some surgery. Main feature of IRIS 2, reduction of the spot size, 350 micron. You will see that is a very narrow and very elegant profile. Reason to go so basically low is that we will be much more effective in quality of ablation, especially in the regular cases where we may change basically the amount of thickness, even 20, 30 micron in 1 millimeter distance. Of course, increasing, reducing the spot means increase the total number of spots to be delivered. For this reason, we exploit the patent that we have basically, which allow us to double the beam laser to finally work. IRIS 2 works at 2 kilohertz. But again, as you know, we will not just run as crazy guys always at 2 kilohertz, but as you will see, the frequency of the head will be automatically controlled from basically very few frequency up to 5 hertz, and then increase up to 2 kilohertz when we are working to remove the epithelium in very large refractive zone. Another one is to deliver, you will see that the spot, we have a brand new optical path, which was ordered to achieve the 350, but also to deliver the beam always perpendicular to the cornea to reduce basically the radial defin periphery. So to increase at the end of the day, the energy per each spot is lower with the IRIS 1 with a factor of 4. Basically, each single spot of an IRIS 2 delivers an amount of energy which is extremely lower than basically IRIS 1, 4 times lower. IRIS 2 implements also a dynamic fixation, because basically implements a control of the angle K, and the dynamic fixation allows the patient to be registered in IRIS 2 with the same angle K as it was registered in IRIS. But on top of this, in order to grant basically avoid any environment condition, we basically, you will see that we have an extensible arm which protect the environment between the patient, the eye of the patient, and the arm of the laser to have a full sealed area to basically minimize any environmental condition. IRES is provided with a dynamic slide window to allow basically to change in between the 193 up to 365, and to allow a 365 a customization of the treatment, changing the diameter of the energy to be irrigated from 2 to 10 millimeters. Again, exactly to be able to reproduce the customized cross-linking plan planned by SIPTA 2. Last, a few information you will get later on answers from also this point of view, but just a few information of our riboflavin solution. You know that our aim is always to be as less invasive as possible. And in order to do this, both SafeCross and SafeCross Plus were designed in order to basically increase the number of links of cross-linking with the same level of energy. So basically, SafeCross has the capability to optimize the availability of the oxygen, allowing at the same level of energy 35 Higer efficiency. On the contrary, we may say that we may reduce, as we are doing right now, of 35% the total time of energy in order to be as less invasive as possible. While SafeCross Plus, which is also a patented technology, SafeCross Plus, thanks to the addition of this acid, the ADDS, which is a totally biocompatible acid, allow to integrate the cross-linking provided by the oxygen with a total parallel activity of reaction, which does not require oxygen, thus basically almost doubling the efficiency of the radicals, and this allowing, opening the door to basically reduce the energy to be irrigated of 50%. We have already basically, I will read the question, we have already 9 questions already proposed by our community. And the first question, Professor Alessio, and there is a question that seems to be exactly addressed to your experience. The question is the contribution of the posterior surface really relevant?
Thank you, Giuseppe. Yes, I think it is very relevant. I think that most of cataract surgeons ask to the company to prepare their biometers with the a new instrumentation to consider also the posterior surface of the cornea. Because in cataract surgery with toric lens, you have some refractive surprise. And with this new instrumentation, you can control in the best mode the results of the astigmatism in the toric lens. So that if it is important in normal eye with only astigmatism, think what is most important in eye that have other kind of aberration. You know that if you perform a cataract in a patient with a keratoconus and you take in account the biometry, normal biometry, you have a result that is very hyperopic, and you ask why. Why the real power of a keratoconic cornea is not the power that you read on your topographer, because the posterior surface is very less negative than a standard cornea. So that a standard index of refraction for the cornea is not correct. We have a lot of patients with 49 diopters, 50 diopters of keratometric value of keratoconic cornea, and they are about emmetropic, or sometimes they are hyperopic. Why? It's not possible. The problem is the posterior surface of the cornea. Now, a friend of mine, Paolo Luciguerra, performed an ablation, topographic ablation with another system, and the rest on a keratoconus cornea. And the results is very fantastic on anterior surface, but the patient worse quality of vision and worse quantity of vision. Why? Because the coma is exactly upside down, because it's too much corrected anterior surface. Now, with the, I used the system on some patient, and the results are very interesting, because you are looking an ablation that is let deep, and in keratoconic cornea you want to remove less tissue it's possible. And the results are, refractive results are very interesting. We have some cases, I think that we, I can show you. Giuseppe, we can see some of my patient. I don't know, okay.
If, can you share the screen? Would you like that we, do you have?
See, you have some my patient.
Yeah, let me ask the Erasmo to share his screen. Excuse me, Daniele. Daniele, can you share the data of Professor Alessio, please?
Yes, let me just.
Okay, we perform some ablation only to regularize the cornea, and we obtain.
Can you see? Sorry, Professor, can you see the screen?
Yes, we can see.
Good.
Can I use it? Okay. Don't go to the patient directly. Giuseppe, show this.
Yeah.
Oh, this is one. Okay. This is the elevation map of the patient number one. And you can see that the posterior surface is more elevated than the anterior. And that means that the posterior is more myopic, and the coma is due to the posterior, especially to the anterior surface, and the posterior surface decreases the coma. Can you go to the second slide? Okay. Okay. This is the coma, total anterior and posterior coma. Come stai facendo?
Is it better now?
Okay, now it's better. This, on the top, you can see the anterior power of the cornea. In the middle is the posterior surface. And how can you see it is more negative where the posterior cornea is more elevated? And the total is the last one down. Go to next slide. Okay, this is a postoperative. How can you see on the anterior surface? You can see that there is a little keratoconus, less than before, but the shame is the same. If you go out, the next slide. Okay, this is the postoperative refractive map. How can you see the total? The anterior map show you a coma. On down there is 319, and in the top is 360. The posterior is on the contrary, and the total in the center is very regular, is light and regular astigmatism. So go to the next slide. Okay, if you can go to the next slide, but the patient remain with glasses, but he have 20/20 with a very good quality of vision. This is another cases. On the top is anterior elevation map, the posterior and the stroma go to the next. And this is the refractive mass. Pre-op, anterior is that you can see on the top. Posterior, that is the contrary, can then decrease the total that is down. Next slide. This is the postoperative of this patient, the anterior, the stroma, and the posterior. But what I can show you is the next. That is what's happened on the refractive. The first is the anterior, the posterior that compensate the low level of coma that is on remain on anterior, and down there is a total map that is very, very good. And you can see never the classic keratoconus pattern. Next slide. That is this one. This is the postoperative refractive. And how can you think it's a simple to correct with my glasses, this eye. Next one is another cases. Are the same order, the elevation. Next. The anterior power. Can you see the posterior is very negative? So the next one, if this is the postoperative in elevation, and the more important is next one in the refractive power, and this is the refractive power in the anterior, but the total going to the next. How can you see in the 5 millimeter of the center is like a regular astigmatism with the two axes that is 19 degrees, one on the other, and you can correct easily, and the patient are very happy.
Thank you, Gianni, for your important contribution. Now, there is another one question, which is, this is relative to the epithelium. And there is someone who would like to know if it's really important to know which one is the refractive contribute of the epithelium. So Giulio, you are using Precisio since a lot of time now, Precisio 2. Would you like please to answer to this question?
Hi, Giuseppe. Can you hear me?
We can hear you very well.
Okay. As you told, I work with the Precisio 2 in the last 4 or 5 years. And now we have a very accurate epithelium map, and we can study the epithelium with the new map that I now show to you. If Daniele can share some slide for...
Can you see the screen?
Yes, it's a very fast. Yes, this is Precisio 2, next one. We know that the capability of detect the epithelium is very accurate and independent from the lacrimal film. Next one. And the most important is that the map of the cornea of the epithelium. Yes, this is a normal cornea. You can see the anterior elevated, and this is the epithelium map. You can go ahead. The epithelium map show you in a regular cornea the point by point epithelium thickness from the center to the periphery until 10 millimeter. And so not only the area of the epithelium, but the point by point epithelium thickness. And we can study the gradient of the epithelium and the refractive impact of the epithelium. In this case, go ahead. We can show the refractive epithelium ray tracing power map. You can see it's almost green because the impact of the epithelium in the normal corneas is almost zero. We study the epithelium in condition where we are sure that the epithelium has changed. For example, in orthokeratological application. Show the next slide. I think, yes, this is a case of orthokeratological application. You can see the anterior map with the flattening in the central region due to the orthokeratological application. And on the left, you can see the stromal surface in the middle and the posterior surface on the bottom. And you can see that the stromal surface is very different from the anterior surface. And this difference is due to the change of the epithelium. Next one, the distribution of the epithelium in orthokeratologic application is very, very similar to a cone. There is a very thinnest point in the central, and around the center, there is a thicker epithelium. In this way, the epithelium create a negative gradient. Next one. And now we can study very well with the map of epithelium retracing map. You can see very, very clear now the negative impact central of the epithelium on the cornea, and this negative lens is the result of the modification of the shape of the epithelium. Next one, we study a lot of cases of this way. This is very interesting. This is an appropriate orthokeratologic application. This is anterior surface of a bad application of the lens. The anterior surface is very irregular, and you can see that if you look at the left in the middle, the stromal surface is very, very, very different to the anterior surface because the irregularity of this cornea is due totally to epithelium distribution. Next one. And if we study with the epithelium TIX map, you can see a very, very regular distribution with the thinnest point in the center, but very regular shape on the periphery of the cornea. Next one, and this aspect of the epithelium cause a chromatic effect and an irregular astigmatism due to inappropriate orthokeratologic application. This data, next one, are very useful for the future for the customization of the epithelium, I think, because with the next, you can go ahead very fast, Daniele, because these things showed Giuseppe few minutes ago. In this way, I think one of the plus of the new system will be the possibility to customize the ablation of the epithelium with the different rates of the ablation, the epithelium between in front of the stroma. Go ahead until the end. But this is a new tools of the ship tattoo, and I'm very confident that the new ablation will be very very good in terms of impact in terms of the impact of the epithelium in the regular cornea. But one of the another tools, you can go until the end, Daniele. The importance of the epithelium map, I want to stress the useful, for example, in the follow-up of the patient. When you have you see a patient, for example, in after 1 month, that had not a good result, visual result after the surgery, with studying the epithelium map, you can understand if the problem of the visual is a problem due to the epithelial regularization, to the healthy of the epithelium, or is the problem is for to think another thing. So you can study the epithelium after the surgery. It's very useful for to understand to speak with the patient in what is the problem for this patient. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Giulio, for your very relevant contribution, especially on those orthokeratologic cases. They are very interesting. Now there is a question which is really related to something where basically it's a very strong point of discussion. Is basically the question is stromal reactivity after corneal remodeling and cross-linking. So somewhat, I mean, what is basically the real risk of AIDS if we combine such technique? I have Professor Mazzotta, who on top of to be a very nice friend of mine, he's a really an expert and he's already using our technology since a lot now. And I think he is the right person to address this question. So please, Cosimo, would you like to give us your opinion about this issue?
Thank you, Giuseppe. Thank you for the invitation. Hi, everyone. Can you see my screen? I have shared my screen.
Yes, we can see.
Yes, we can see.
Thank you. So it is a good point. And I hope to give you some input that will be useful in your clinical practice based on evidence-based literature. First of all, what I want to say is that the major causes of cross-linking complications and cross-linking plus corneal remodeling complications are not related directly to the technique, but in the major part, we have complications related to contact lens bandage, hygiene, poor hygiene, compliance of patients, environmental factors. Moreover, are most important the evaluation, the preoperative evaluation of the ocular surface diseases, in particular the presence of blepharitis, the presence of meibomian gland dysfunction, the presence of previous corneal, preoperative corneal opacities, and if patients are eye rubbers or not. And then we go to the technical surgery, so the patient selection, to the surgical technique, and if we combine cross-linking with excimer laser photoablation, and also the consistency of our technique application. First, let me say that we have two completely different situations, because on your left, you have the AIDS post-PRK, and on your right, you have an AIDS post-cross-linking. We are speaking about different clinical entities, different pathogenesis with some common aspects that I will show you, different clinical experience, different therapeutic response, influence on visual acuity is also different, and also therapeutic management and prevention is different. You know the clinical appearance of the AIDS after PRK that is more superficial, it is reticular, it is hypertrophic, and involve the anterior stroma where the ablation is performed and the area surrounding the ablation zone. While the AIDS post-cross-linking is diffuse, is generally deeper, is something different from the post-PRK AIDS. Take a look to this slide. So when we do a PRK, we induce a signal that activates the TGF bed-induced factor, the transforming growth factor, the plasmin. We increase signal interactions. We induce a keratocyte damage with apoptosis. We activate all the keratocytes that are situated in the wound borders and in the deeper tissue that is not reached by the ablation. There is an increase in the release of cytokines, the repopulation of the anterior stroma, and the activation of keratocytes induce an activation and differentiation of these cells into myofibroblasts, precursors that generally come back to the status of keratocytes. While if you go over into the status of fibroblasts or remain like myofibroblasts, they increase collagen deposition that is like a scarring collagen tissue. You can see here the different that when we perform a cross-linking, we induce a keratocyte apoptosis that is directly involved with the technique. So the UV radiation, the interaction with riboflavin and the radical oxygen radical, reactive oxygen species release. Also here, we have an activation of TGF-beta, interleukins, a signal interaction, and we induce a differentiation of myofibroblast. We induce new collagen deposition after the repopulation of the stroma, and we inactivate the collagenase. In this case, we inactivate the activity of the enzymes that are really important as scavengers of the irregular collagen that is positioned in the stroma and in the extracellular matrix that is fundamental to clear the stroma in the postoperative. You know that the age of cross-linking is different because we have a peak in the first 1 to 3 months, we have a plateau at 6 months, and then we have a decrease in time because we have the scavengers, we have the collagenase activity, we have the new differentiation from precursors of myofibroblasts that come back to the status of keratocytes. And so the matrix is cleared progressively and the cornea become more transparent. This is my first article that show within cornea the apoptosis of keratocytes. You can see here the apoptosis of cells, the spongy or lacunar edema, and the activation of the keratocyte nuclei in the wound, in the border, in which the area is not reached in the deep stroma, but we are very deep. You can see here the depth is 342 microns. It's not really similar to the PFK, of course. And I have also demonstrated in this article in the American Journal the repopulation timing and the activation of keratocyte nuclei and the new extracellular matrix structure after cross-linking proceedings from an hyperdense tissue that is something that we want in the beginning to a more cleared tissue in time. So sometime you could have an hyperdensity of the stroma in cross-linking that is really useful for our patients because it is like a very good sign of our treatment impact inside the cornea. But we need to distinguish what we mean with AIDS in cross-linking procedure. I have also graduated, this was the first case in the world describing the stromal AIDS after the cross-linking, but I want to show this slide. I have graduated the AIDS in cross-linking in 5 grades. So we have grade 1, grade 2, and grade 3. That are simply AIDS with the temporary hyperdensity of the stroma that don't affect negatively the visual acuity of the patients and are temporary. It may last about 3 to 6 to 12 months, but they come back and restore a clearness of the stroma. While we may have also the G4 and the G5, there is the G3 that is something in between. It is an intermediate state of AIDS. We have an hyperdensity. We have a temporary visual acuity decay, a glare disability in these patients that may last also for 12 months, but also this kind of AIDS come back. While we have the G5 and the G4, that it is a scarring process, a real scarring, in which the AIDS persists over 12 months and negatively affects visual acuity. This is published in the Ocular Surface Journal with also Professor Afezi, with Brad Landelman, George Kimionis, and other eminent authors. We know that how we can prevent the AIDS. First of all, we introduced the use of pulsed light in cross-linking treatment. What we know about the comparative evaluation in vivo by means of a scanning laser confocal microscopy, what we know is that when we use continuous light cross-linking protocols, so the Dresden protocol, we have an increased activation keratocytes, we have an increased level of apoptosis, we have an increased level of cytokines, we have an increased differentiations of keratocytes into myofibroblasts and increased probability of AIDS. We have also published that using the pulsed light versus the continuous one, we take 3 advantages. First, we increase our demarcation like that because with the pulsing the light, we increase radical release and we increase oxygenation of the tissue during the treatment. we improve stromal oxygenation, so the overall cross-linking efficiency is improved. And in particular, I demonstrated that we induce less microstructural damage. So we have less AIDS if we use pulsed light treatments. And this article was confirmed, this hypothesis was confirmed by Oriental authors, Liang, Zhu Yang, and Shi Yang Qiu, that published the comparative study of conventional versus pulsed light accelerated cross-linking and demonstrated that their findings were consistent with my findings that were previously published with less amount of edema, less microstructural damage, less risk of permanent AIDS if we use pulsed light in our combined treatments. So, in particular, we have the balanced lamina for ablation in this case. So we go deeper, so we increase keratocyte apoptosis, so we increase keratocyte activation, and we increase differentiation process. So another important thing is to a good postoperative management with the topical ophthalmic corticosteroids. Since the beginning of our postoperative therapeutic regimen, because it must not be suboptimal treatment, because we may fail to prevent this occurrence. Take a look to this article. This article was published in February this year in the Journal of Refractive Surgery. And what about the use of mitomycin after cross-linking? And what's about the use of mitomycin in combined procedure where the cross-linking is the last procedure we do? Not when we do cross-linking before and then after 1 year or 2 years or 6 months, we do PRK. So in this case, we can use mitomycin because we are treating the PRK, post-PRK dates. But we must be cautiously because we don't need to use, we need to avoid to use mitomycin after cross-linking. It was demonstrated by these authors. You know that mitomycin is an alkylating agent, block DNA and RNA replication and protein synthesis. It was shown that it is an anti-proliferative drug and cytotoxic drugs on human keratocytes. And it was demonstrated that prevents and reduces AIDS formation after PRK. But after cross-linking, mitomycin increases the percentage of AIDS. So we need to avoid mitomycin after cross-linking, and we need to avoid mitomycin in our combined procedure where we do first corneal remodeling with laser excimer, and then we do cross-linking. What are the reasons? If you take these two, I have also put here one of my articles in the American Journal demonstrating the early and the late modifications of stroma after cross-linking. You can see here that mitomycin has an apoptotic effect on the resident quiescent keratocyte population that is synergistic with cross-linking. So this results in a major cell dropout in the treated cornea. The reduced density and the mitotic activity of keratocytes interfere with their reparatory role, resulting in a diminished capacity to repopulate the injured areas and diminished the removal, the scavenging of unorganized collagen laid down by the myofibroblast. So the larger magnitude of apoptosis induced by the concomitant use of mitomycin with cross-linking may result in a larger amount also of cytokine release. And these cytokines play an important role in the differentiation and maturation of keratocytes into myofibroblasts. Not only this, but the increased differentiation sites and the deposition, the greater deposition of disorganized collagen that can no longer be cleared out by the apoptotic keratocyte increased by mitomycin and collagenase activity are inhibited by cross-linking also because we have also a biochemical effect, not only a biomechanical effect. So the use of mitomycin should be always avoided after any cross-linking procedure and high caution after cross-linking combined with cross. Let me say the last word on what Giuseppe introduced in SPG cross-linking customization. I think it could be very a great advancement in this treatment, because if we follow the gradient, the stromal gradient pachymetry, releasing a differentiated energy according to the gradient, so increased our power energy in the major focal area of ectasia and reducing the energy when we go to the intermediate area of the ectasia and to the periphery where the ectasia is not present, we can spare a lot of energy. So we can spare a lot of keratocyte activation, a lot of cytokines released into the stroma. So we can save more probability of AIDS development in the post-operative. If SIFTA2 allows to plan this kind of customized prosthetic procedure and also by the precision2 analysis, so it is really amazing. If you see this old graphic, you can see here that if we customize, we reduce the energy, and also we can use the safe cross power to increase the superoxide anion. So we can compensate the energy that we reduce with the higher amount of superoxide anion release conferred by the safe cross and the safe cross plus solution. So we don't lose efficacy in the treatment. We spare only energy of the laser. And this is really amazing with the, not only with the safe cross. I have just published the first article about the use, the clinical use of the safe cross in the Journal of Clinical Medicine this year. And also the power, the addiction of ethylene diaminas disuccinic acid that increase the release of superanion oxygen release and the radical in about 1.90 micromole for milliliters is very good. So my 10 rules to conclude are to minimize the risk of stromal wound-related complications are to minimize surgical invasiveness. So I think that the technology of Giuseppe meets this point. We need to avoid, absolutely, to avoid the Dresden Protocol in this case. The 3 milliwatt is forbidden in this case because we have a lot of activation of keratocytes and a greater collagen deposition. We need to avoid 30 minutes soaking. We need only 10 minutes of corner soaking with safe cross. We need to avoid dextran, of course, all hypotonic solution. Avoid the mitomycin. Please, no mitomycin after cross-linking, and use isotonic riboflavin solution. The use of standardized fluents is also recommended, but of course we trust in Giuseppe technology in the future for the variable fluents according to the gradient. It could be a very good experience in our future. So we will test all together this. This option, and use the pulsed light, please, because you will have better corneas, better stroma, and use also appropriate postoperative regimens. Be careful to the ocular surface, to blepharitis, to comorbidities factor, that can influence your results. I think in conclusion that AIDS will be far to reduce it if we customize the cross-linking using the stromal pachymetry gradient, if we deliver also some safe cross solution to increase the power of this treatment. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Cosimo, for your brilliant presentation. It was really extensive, and I think it covered more than enough, absolutely, the question. We have now basically a couple of questions, which basically I would like Alex. Alex.
Hello.
Hi, friend. So, two questions for you. Why to customize the transition zone? It's really important. And why also customize the epithelium removal?
Yes, well, those questions were most of it already answered. But let's just touch this customized transition zone. Most of the, or all of the other system, none of the other system considered a non-treated cornea that is surrounding our ablation. And nobody is really looking how our ablation is going to connect to the untreated cornea. And this is one of the best features of the IV system, is that we are designing an ablation with also customized transition zone. And we know that epithelium is remodeling very much in cases that we get a steep gradient change. And this is what our transition zone in IVIS system addresses. And it allows, most importantly, healing that is not disturbing the result of our planned ablation. And the other thing is the optical aspect of the whole thing. Having the customized transition, we get much better result optically, then resulting in less halos and disturbances with which normally a small optical zone will result in. So that was the first question about the transition zone. We have seen the slides earlier in Giuseppe's presentation, so we don't have to look at that. But let us now look at this other aspect. I will try to share the screen. Here we are. Let's just see if, it is functioning. Yes. Customized epithelial removal is of special importance in irregular cases, and this is what I'm going to focus on. We know that looking at the PRK and transepithelial PRK, this is the main first thing we have to have in mind. So that using normal PRK for treating our irregular cases will be totally inappropriate. First, let us look at this example. We have irregular cornea to begin with, and then this is our refractive map. Then with mechanical epithelial removal, we get the stromal surface to appear. And we know that stromal surface is much more irregular than the surface covered by the epithelium. So then if we construct our ablation according to the situation with the epithelium on, with normal topography, which is normally done in any topography guided treatment, then our ablation will be treating unknown surface, or the surface of this uncovered stroma, which has different morphological features and different optics, of course. And the treatment of this is an anterior topography guided ablation profile applied to the stroma will lead still to a significant residual irregularity which we see on this refractive map below. So this is like the first important thing of not using PRK. The other thing is about the customizing the epithelial removal. With just using transmitter PRK, we could actually use a fixed epithelial depth and achieve relatively reasonably good result. But if we have a more accurate registering of our epithelium profile, and if we include that in our ablation plan, then we will achieve also a couple of things. But among others, we will use lower amount of tissue ablated. So this is the profile with the epithelium in gray, and this is this protruding stroma with blue. And if we use the standard 64 microns epithelial thickness in our ablation plan for the lamellar portion, then we will definitely use much more tissue than we need. With transepithelial, we can see some clinical cases here. We have preoperative anterior elevation map with the stromal map, which is more irregular, more steep, and then we have epithelial map, which is actually represent the difference between the two. And this is the ray tracing power below of the same thing, anterior, more irregular ray tracing power with stromal topography, and preoperative epithelial refractive power, which we see is negative. If we do transepithelial ablation with a SIPTA 2 system, which allows for epithelial separate programming of the epithelial portion, we will end up with a situation on the right with a customized epithelial ablation. On the left is that in the standard one, which is just compensate for the radial deficiency, otherwise it's a lamellar ablation. And we will end up with a total ablation map, which is much more tissue removal than with the customized one. And not only that, our separate programming of the epithelial and stromal ablation will allow us to consider the difference in ablation rates between epithelium and stroma, which is still a major point of complaint in using transepithelial treatments, where we use the same ablation rate, of course, for the whole treatment, global treatment of both epithelium and stroma. So the result is less use of stromal tissue, less total ablation depth, and of course, as I mentioned, we consider the different ablation rates, and we get much more precise result. Well, thank you. Yes, that was.
You have the microphone.
Okay, excuse me. We have the last clinical question which I would like. This is really a question regarding glare in connection with the optical zone. And Giulio, you are one of our users, then since a lot of time now reduces. Follow the path of reducing the optical zone in order to minimize the invasiveness of the surgery. Would you like to answer to this question, please?
Yes, I don't want to spend a lot of words about the theoretically based basis of this question. I want only to share what happens in my experience from a lot of years using a customizing connecting zone. Because even if we need to reduce the what we named optical zone, if we can customize the connected zone, the zone between the treated corner and the untouched corner, with a gradient constant and with a constant gradient of curvature, we can obtain a larger refractive optical zone. So I have a lot of surgeons, of new surgeons, that are very afraid when they see the SIPTA program and they see optical zone 1 millimeter or 2 millimeter or 3 millimeter. We can go ahead with the slide that are not important. The important is that in SIPTA 1, I don't know if in SIPTA 2 we have a new function for to understand better what I want to say. In SIPTA 1, optical zone, you can see 3 millimeter, but really, if you regularize the connecting zone from 3 millimeter of the refractive zone until 8 or 9 millimeter toward the periphery with the gradient constant, with the if you know exactly the power of the cornea with the data of Precisio 2, you can obtain, you can go ahead with the slide, you can obtain a very larger real refractive optical zone. So what I suggest to Giuseppe is to change the name of the optical zone of SIPTA, especially basically in CCR, because when you speak with other surgeon that you start with optical zone 0.1 millimeters, they are very, very afraid. But what is important is that these are not the real optical zone, but it's the starting point from to regularize the corner. When we can customize the connected zone, we really achieved a very larger optical zone that minimizes at all the risk of glare, of halos, even if the classical optical zone is not so large. This is my experience, personal experience. And of course, if you reduce the optical zone, we have some. You have some advantages. You can spare tissue. Of course, you can treat different level of myopia, even if you have not too much cord to ablate.
Thank you, Giulio. I mean, thank you for your suggestion. As you know, we exactly decided to change the name of optical zone in just defining the ideal shape of the cornea, because at the end of the day, as you correctly say, this is what we do. Now, there is another one question, which is more, I mean, a technical question. Someone asked us if there is any analysis of comparison between Maris and IRIS 2. No, there is no comparison between IRIS 2, because IRIS 2 just got right now the CE approval. And so I'm sure that in the future there will be some comparison. In the past, there were comparison in between IRIS 1 and Maris, especially for the therapeutic cases, but actually no comparison at all for IRIS 2. Now, there are two very technical questions which I would like one of my guys to answer, the responsible of the web connection. But before of this technical question, I would like to know if there is any any question about all of the argument that up now was discussed in order to basically, again, have an open round table. So any question?
Excuse me, Mr. De Polito. If somebody wants to ask question, you can autonomously activate the microphone.
Thank you,
Giuseppe,
for this.
Please. Yes, pulse mode for cross-linking is will be able in RSQ.
Yes, of course. We will have all of the availability. Of course, I mean, we will have possibility to range from 3 to 40 milliwatts. And of course, with any kind of continuous or pulsed. But overall, what will be extremely important, Giulio, is that basically there will be this very strict connection in between the gradient and of the stroma and the fluence, the way that actually we presume that the total energy that will be derived will be much lower. So I'm also answering to, there was a question from Michael about this, and I will take opportunity to answer to also to this question. Michael, I mean, as we said, I mean, the gradient maps, I'm sure you noted it, that the gradient basically are overall related to basically a definition of, let's say, on LT cornea. We studied several LT cornea and we came out with basically a value of the gradient, which is, let's say, safe, okay? Actually, I mean, due to the reason that ectatic deformation are, of course, viscous deformation, because we have a slippage, we have an evident slippage of the stromal fiber. Basically, this slippage is as much as advanced as, and this is already well demonstrated by several, basically now, acquisition that we did with Precisio 2 since now at least a couple of years. What it's really evident is that the higher the gradient, the higher the ectasia. It's not at all related with the minimum thickness. All of you know that we have cornea of 350 micron in the average on the entire cornea that they do not have at all any kind of ectasia. While on the contrary, we may have cornea even more of 500 micron that they present a quite relevant basically ectasia. And if you look at this, you will see that the gradient is always a terrible gradient, well below a threshold of 20 millimeter per basically 20 micron per millimeter. So at the end of the day, I mean, if of course, I mean, this customization will be subject, of course, to clinical trial. And you, Michael, you know, as much as we did with iVerify in order to improve the ablation rate. Of course, I do expect, basically, with customization, after a first round of treatment, we will be even more able to even reduce further the energy. But at least at beginning, of course, we will start with a very prudential approach, reducing energy, but with a level of safety that for sure will not basically cause any collateral problem. At least this is our expectation.
My concern, I'm just wondering that if you only treat the part of the cornea that has a significantly changed gradient, if you rely on the gradient measurements, mm-hmm. if you only treat that cornea, we all know that keratoconus, for instance, extends through life. That your peripheral cornea becomes more affected with time. If you only treat the part of the cornea that has already changed, then you may miss the part of the cornea that is going to change in the future and still have ectatic change over a period of time, even though the central part of the cornea is rigid. The peripheral more peripheral cornea becomes unstable with time. And I'm wondering if we just customize it to that one area that is already seriously affected, as demonstrated by the gradient, we may miss the fact that in the future, the rest of the cornea may become diseased.
Well, Michael, let me tell you, I mean, I will deliver you some gradient maps so you will see. I mean, the gradient is very, very sensitive. What I want to explain is that actually there is not a barrier like a wall where we say here the gradient, but it's a continuous change. And actually we may basically say, just to let you know, we may decide because you, as all of the customization, as you customize the transition zone, here, of course, we also customize the limits. You may say, look, I want to customize even for gradient below 20 micron. Of course, so, and this will basically protect you. But at the end of the day, the big advantage. So basically, you have not a predefined border. The border is automatically defined according to the gradient that you will enter as limit where you want to come.
Fair enough. Yeah.
So, you know, there will be a very large opportunity. As well, as always, I mean, we have to provide such a capability. Then it will be, of course, the experience. You know what we did, for example, for I-Verify for the lateral efficiency. Now it is very solid, but at the beginning, of course, this was subject to optimization, but always looking from the safety of the patient, for sure. I mean,
I agree with Michael's observation, because we know that also the periphery of the cornea go through the ectasia in time. We know also this from lamellar surgeries or from corneal transplants, that we had a lot of wound dehiscence of the wounds in the ears. So the ectasia starts focally, but then generalize. So it is really important, I think, I agree with Michael, that we need to do a base of cross-linking with 9 diameters with 9 millimeter diameters. And then we need to customize the treatment focally following the gradient. So
Maybe I was not enough clear, Cosimo. Let me explain better. When we say customized,
I think it's good to explain better.
Yeah. Let me say, when we say customized does not mean make always lower than 9 millimeter. On the contrary, it may even say go to 10 millimeter. Be attention. I mean, because what we are looking is exactly, I mean, the gradient. And if, as you said, the gradient, like in a pellucida, for example, if the gradient is very far in the periphery, then of course we will go for sure up to that direction, because basically the customization is not only on the diameter, and we go up also to 10, but also the centration. We will never basically center it just in the center of the cornea, but it will be overall centered where the gradient exploits the maximum distance. So basically, for sure, I mean, customization will be a tool in this direction.
Perfect.
So any further question?
Giuseppe?
Yes?
Giuseppe?
Urs, how are you, Urs?
Hello. I have a question. Schwind makes, advertises an ablation similar to the Technis Eyhance to extend the depth of focus. They make the negative spherical spherical aberration high more minus. So what do you think about that?
I suppose you are speaking about a multifocal treatment for presbyopia. Am I right?
Not multifocal. It's monofocal, but it runs with the spherical aberration.
Right, I understand what you mean. See, Urs, I mean, actually, we are going quite long in our meeting, and I'm very glad that all of you pay so much attention. But let me just say that through the as you know, basically, even in IRIS 1, we basically provide the possibility to have a multifocal correction with a connecting zone, which is basically, I would say, even more advanced than what Amaris claims. But let me tell you what will be the SIPTA 2, what we will provide. Actually, I mean, the SIPTA 2 will provide the capability that through the ray tracing, you will basically set up where you want your focusing point at 30 millimeters, 30 centimeters, excuse me, 35, 40. And then the ray tracing will provide you basically the effective shape to be delivered on the cornea in order to create basically this multifocal approach, but where you will have basically a connection between the central zone and the periphery, the way that you will need absolutely to minimize the risk of glare. Now, the point is, Urs, that in such a cases, of course, we are always speaking of a compromise, because at the end of the day, we are making a modification on the cornea that our brain should be able to basically control. What I can tell you is that, and we can show you basically in the web connection how it works, and you will see basically also with our convolution approach what it will imply from a quality of vision for the patient. You will like it very much, but this will require basically a dedicated session. Actually, we are going quite long, and what I really would like to provide you is to give you now a hint on what really the 4D suite is right now, because I think that you will really very much appreciate the capability of the 4D suite. And I would really suggest that this time, due to the reason that actually we are almost at 4 o'clock, I would suggest to do like this to Daniele, to all of my team. I mean, we will have now this technical answer to a couple of questions that were raised up by Claude. And we will go immediately later with a web demonstration of the IV suite. While the SIPT experience, I would basically, due to the reason that we are quite far and we have our friends from Australia and from China, that it's quite late in the evening for them. What I would suggest is that after the demo of the 4D suite, we will deliver you a message asking to whoever you want to have a virtual experience on SIPTA2 to just send us an email, and we will organize in the next following day a dedicated demo for each one of you which is really interested to see the SIPTA. So yours, we could basically then organize this demo, and you will see how SIPTA2 will approach basically this issue of presbyopia. And now let me have Erasmo. Erasmo is our web basically expert in the SIPTA planning. And there are two questions that were addressed by Claude, and Erasmo will provide an answer to these two questions. The first one is, can SIPTA2 be locally installed? And the second one is, how do you basically ensure that the SIPTA2 online calculation work despite the hospital's firewall? Erasmo, please, would you please provide an answer?
Yes, good evening to everyone. Talking about first question, can the software be installed locally? We can see that in the next future, a dedicated local server configuration will be implemented in case where the internet connection is not available or partially available. So we can provide a hybrid cloud connection environment to this particular case or for particular compliance issue. About the last question, I can say that about the data used in IVIS for the suite medical devices, we have devices, physical devices like Precisio or Iris that are installed in the hospital, and other devices like SIPTA2 that is available on the cloud. So the data will be sent from a physical device in the hospital to the cloud by means one network connection provided by hospital IT organization. And in this case, we follow the compliance with IEC 80001, and we can define rules, responsibility, and activity for the risk management of IT network. But I can add also that data that are sent to the cloud are stored and encrypted in a data center with the gold standard security practice.
Thank you, Erasmo. And now a short communication to my team. We will go now as discussed just with the web demo, the virtual demo on the 4D suite. And we will postpone to a following day the SIPTA2 interactive virtual experience to avoid to have our team, our user to be too much addressed by too many things. So let's now basically start with the web demo. Before to start the web demo, let me give you a hint on how it will be organized. As you know, as we said, basically SIPTA2 is the center of our Ivy suite. And it acts basically as an element of exchange of the data. So what we will see right now is that the possibility of the optometrists of or the nurse to introduce the relevant information of the patient directly in SIPTA2 with any media, in order then to basically have all of this data available in the network. So we will basically, for one patient, now run this medical record, introduce basically a visit. Of course, each visit may be updated over time, and the visit will be automatically linked with the Precisio acquisition and the P-metric acquisition, which are closed in terms of dates. Of course, all of these may be controlled by remote. After this, we will link to a Precisio, make an acquisition, export to SIPTA. We will see that once the export is automatically executed, if there are all of the information which are relevant to plan the ablation, which means on top of topographic data, pupillometric data, refractive data, if we introduce all of this data, you will see that in the SIPTA web, the planning is automatically executed, the way to avoid you to waste time to plan the ablation, according, of course, with the setting that you already selected. So we will basically look at this case, and then export from SIPTA to IRIS2, and then we will see how IRIS2 works. It will take basically from 15 to an half an hour, but I think it will be quite interesting to see for all of you. So Erasmo, would you please start, for example, for the first patient, let's create this medical record here. So this is our basically screen, and now we will basically enter in our diagnostic session. We will create the new patient. And after creating the patient, we will basically introduce the data that are, of course, the result of our visit, which may be, we may just simply introduce basically the refraction. But of course, for example, we have a second patient that we will see later on, which is a post-transplantation. So we may compile any relevant information that from a clinical point of view, it is needed. So let's run this Francesco Ragni, this patient. Now the structure of the medical record is created. Now we will enter the visit for this patient. And let's say that our patient here is has a CDVA of 20 on 20 with a sphere of -2, a cylinder of -175, at 160. And well, we don't want to waste time on clinical ocular story, so we save it. Now this data is delivered into the web, and it's now going to Precisio to be uploaded into the Precisio. Let's, I will also show on top of this, I will also show another one case that we will just see later on. We will be quite fast, but this case is one of our employee who was got surgery a few years ago, lamellar transplantation. Can we run this other patient, Daniele? This patient, you see, actually, in order to short time, we are just showing you now the elevation map for this patient. Can we show, for example, for this patient, Erasmo, let's look at the differential map. Okay, look at here. Those are, this is, I would define this patient like a very critical patient. If we go and look, for example, the pachymetric data for this patient, we may see that, look at the epithelial maps. Go to the epithelial maps, Erasmo, please. Okay, look at here. I mean, we see that in the central zone, the epithelium is, overall, it's a very thick epithelium, but in the central zone is relevantly thinner than in the periphery. And if we see in terms of basically refractive power of the epithelium, can we look at it as? Look, it seems like really a myopic treatment. We see that we have almost 2.5 spherical negative correction in the center with respect to the periphery. So once again, the epithelium plays a relevant role. Now, if we look at the ray tracing of this guy, look how irregular is the refractive map. And in fact, for this patient, basically, there was a barely evaluation of the astigmatism of minus 6.5 diopter at basically 170 degrees. There was no possibility to make spherical correction. But thanks to the ray tracing, what we do in such a cases, we do introduce basically the biometric data, which were exactly introduced in such a case. And the biometric data are basically relevant to do what? To basically allow ray tracing the way that the ideal shape will take care exactly of the total axial length in order basically to target the ideal ablation for such a patient. Now, if we look at basically the quality of vision of this patient, look basically in such a case, go on the PSF, Erasmo. Look how far is basically the tilting for this patient, which was induced due basically to the irregularity. I'm sure you notice it. Can you go back for a moment in the elevation, Erasmus, we show them basically, can you clearly see how basically there is a more pronounced deepening of the cornea in the inferior nasal side here. And as a consequence, I mean, we have basically a movement of the BSF in the opposite direction. Go back again on the quality of vision, Erasmus, please. And we see, now go to photopic pupil, please, not just 1 millimeter, because this is the pinhole. Look basically how irregular is the distribution of the ray which impact onto the retina. And in fact, if we look, the quality of vision, expected quality of vision of this map is really blurred. And curious to say that we asked to the person, do you see like this? And she said that, yes, she was very similar with her uncorrected quality of vision. So now, basically, what we will do, go, for example, now, Erasmo, please, to the eye tracker. Let's show them how the eye tracker works. Look, here was basically the point spread function. Those are what you see over there, the movement of the spot. They represent, each one of them is the position of the eye during the acquisition. As you see, there are several points that are quite out of the 0.2 degree of central fixation. Erasmo, please, let's show them how the compensation works. Okay, you see here, this was the pre-op. And actually, after the correction, you see now the eye is completely stopped and you see just a movement of the eyelids. So at the end of the day, basically, this is the reason why we could get such level of repeatability even for a so bad cornea. Now, I mean, I would like also to go to the next step, and let's go to the ablation plane that we did for this patient. You see, the ablation is basically a very narrow ablation. It's the software automatically brought the refractive zone up to 1.6 millimeter, but with the smoothing connection up to 7.8 millimeter. And if we see, look at AI TCR, say, for basically compensating the profile of the ablation, taking care of basically the biometric data. Erasmo, can you show basically the biometric data that were introduced for the patient? You see here thickness basically of the pachymetry, anterior chamber depth thickness, lens thickness, and total axial length. Of course, the ray tracing is based according to this parameter. And so even in case, in a case like this, where no spherical refraction could be basically executed due to basically the very poor quality of vision, by the way, however, we get such ablation. And now let me show you the difference in between a case like this, where we have basically a standard epithelium, as we see. But Erasmo, please make the difference in between the standard and the customized epithelium. Okay, as you may see, basically in the stromal difference, we have a higher ablation in the center, because you see, let's look for a moment to the epithelial ablation of the customized side, Erasmo. Look at here, in such a case, we are going, due to the thickness of the epithelium, here we are going well above the 54 micron of a standard epithelium. And this will allow us basically to really match the refractive zone of this patient. If we go now back again and compare the total ablation, which is the summation of the epithelial and the stromal ablation, if we go to the total difference, we see that on the total difference, we have an increase of epithelium. We are exactly now in the opposite case of the keratoconus that we saw before, where we were reducing our ablation. In such a case, we need to ablate in the periphery of the ablation, even 14 micron more of epithelium in order to take care of the stratification of the epithelium of this person. Now, we may, let's look for a moment the expected post-op map here, especially in terms of basically quality of vision. Okay. Here we see that we are remodeling the central zone. But look at here now, the PSF, as you may see, is completely, so we took care of the of basically of the first order. Now we do expect now to come out with a best focusing point centered, of course, with an improved quality of vision. Look, if we look, go, Erasmo, would you please go back in, this is photopic, 1 millimeter, go to photopic. Okay, and now to go to the 6 millimeter. Actually, we are not regularizing up to the 6 millimeter. So you may see that there is a dispersion of the point in the periphery, but that is completely mitigated. It's, you see, it is very smooth. You see, there is no basically dense spot. And this is the reason why we do expect this patient to avoid to have glare or halos. Okay. This is the expected quality of vision at 6 millimeter for this patient. Go on the quality of vision, Erasmo, please. Okay. So now this is again to explain what Giulio was telling before, that it's not 1/6 millimeter, the optical zone, because we are making a constant gradient which will not have an impact on the glare or halos, but it will allow us to reduce a lot the volume of ablation. So now we may export this ablation, Erasmo, and send it, please, to the laser. Let's also show for a moment an ectatic case, Erasmo, please, because we want also to show how the cross-linking works in the laser. So the dot is showing now that the export to the laser is going on. And now we go to back after the export to the laser. Let's go back now to the last ectatic case that we were just discussing now. Okay, this is quite advanced ectasia. As we discussed, we see, let's look at the difference here also to show the capability of Precisio 2. You see, this is the difference in between the two acquisitions. Let's go now on the pachymetry and show the epithelial maps. We see that, of course, there is a relevant inner in the center. Let's look at the refractive map of the epithelium here. Look here, we have basically a chromatic contribution of over three diopters. This again, this is the reason why intrastromal surgery cannot work on the complex cases, but also PRK cannot work in such a cases. And if we go here now in the ray tracing map, we may see how basically the posterior reduces basically the aberration on of the anterior shape. We see that the total cornea is much less aberrated than, of course, the anterior. And if we go in quality of vision, we may expect, of course, also here an offset. Look at the offset, of course, here. It's very far, the offset. And again, if we go to basically go to photopic pupil here, we see that again, the image is relevantly aberrated for such a patient. Now let's go on the plan for this patient. Erasmo, please. Look at here. If we look at the difference, for example, in such a case, EACR stay for anterior total remodeling. So basically we are forgetting about the posterior shape. Let's show basically to all of our friends, Erasmo, the difference in between the total corneal remodeling with respect to the anterior, still keeping now the standard epithelium. Okay. Look, we are at level of the stroma, we are saving 19 micron of tissue for the reason why that, of course, we are removing much less because we are leaving the cone. And if we look to the refractive expected maps, go to ray tracing, Erasmo, perfect. Look at here, the anterior provides a very regular shape, but if we go on total, we see that we induce a chromatic effect in the opposite direction. On the contrary, if we look at the ETCR, the anterior still have a chromatic effect due to the cone that we, partial cone that we left, but now the total cornea is much more regular. And this is also quite evident in quality of vision. Please go on quality of vision. Here we see that basically the post-op in the total case is centered and basically well-centered. While go to the photopy, let's show basically Erasmo the a little more larger. Okay, so it's very centered. Now let's look at the anterior now. We see now the spot is moved slightly over because we are now, this is the effect of the posterior shape, okay? Which leaves, go to the quality of vision, which still leaves a slight aberration, as you may see on the cornea. Now, let's look at the difference before making exportation also of this case. Let's look at the difference between the total corneal remodeling with the total epithelium, excuse me, and standard epithelium. So in such a case, what we expect? To have a stromal ablation, as you see, much higher, because basically in such a case, the epithelium is thinner. And so we, the laser now will know that those 30 micron in the center, those are really micron of stroma with the ablation rate of stroma and not of the epithelium. But if we go on total, go to total, please. We see that on total, I mean, the total amount, due to the reason that in the periphery, the epithelium of this patient is quite regular, there is almost no difference in such a case. On the contrary, if the epithelium would have been much more thinner, we would have been even saving tissue with customized ablation. Now, what we can do here, before making the exportation, please let's show, of course, now we will select the total corneal ablation with customized plan, but let's look now at the cross-linking plan that will be exported together. You see, this is the stromal gradient, and you see that now, basically, where there is the minimum of the thickness, we have the maximum increase of the energy to be irradiated, which is low down to the periphery, but you also see that the energy here is not centered in the map, but is decentered. Can we show also, basically, Erasmo, the standard ablation? This would have been the standard ablation for this guy, okay? So finally, now let's go back to customize it. And let's export also this example. So at the end of the day, we will see on the laser now, basically this irregular case, the exit of transplantation, this keratoconus with the cross-linking. And now we will enter to we will show you now basically in the meantime how basically the remote connection did basically the automated plan of ablation. Okay, so after the exportation, now we can go back to Francesco Ragni, to the patient which was exported, as you will remember, basically in Precisio. And see the plan that was automatically produced. Oh, actually, I forgot. I mean, for this patient, we still did not get precision. Excuse me. I mean, I was too fast. I mean, so let's go and acquire the precision exam for the patient, Erasmo. Okay. So can we go here for the patient and show basically do the acquisition and see how the medical, you see the medical record was imported. So here we have already in Precisio the refraction of the patient, which you remember we put -2 at -175 at 60 with 20 on 20. Now let's go to the next and let's acquire the exam. So we start, as you know, with the automatic acquisition. I mean, most of you are familiar. Actually, the Precisio will automatically acquire the two exam and make the difference analysis. As you know, the second acquisition will be only needed in order to basically validate the acquisition of the first exam. So this is the first acquisition done. Of course, we are looking at it now in real time. Second acquisition done. Now the processing. As you may see, automatically validation, those are the two acquisitions. You see the repeatability is well below 3 micron. So go ahead now and go fast. Please go in view. And let's now go in the export function to plan the surgery. Okay, so let's, I will not stop here. This is a regular patient. I will not take too much of your time. But as you see here, the attempted correction is already here. So we have not to basically do any further job. Just now, SIPTA design, and we export to the SIPTA web. So please, let's go ahead and export, please. Of course, if you want to edit, you can go in advanced capabilities, in advanced URSS. If you are still online in advanced, you have the possibility, of course, to introduce the multifocal correction, as well the angle K correction, as well as to introduce the biometric data. But now, basically, the export of the data are already delivered to SIPTA, and the SIPTA, at this time, due to the reason that all of the data are already there, is basically automatically making the plan of the ablation the way that you have not to wasting time in planning the ablation. In the meantime, now, due to the fact that we are quite late, in the meantime, SIPTA will plan. Let's go and execute the first treatment with IRIS. So let's start with the treatment, please, of Maria Giulia of the lamellar transplantation. So if we can go, let me know if we can go directly to the laser, and in the meantime that SIPTA will plan the ablation, show to all of our friends now how IRIS work.
Yes, please, I need just 1 minute.
Any question up to this moment, my friend?
Giuseppe, can I ask a question?
Of course.
Really, it's not of you. It's of Giulio and Alex and the others that are already using the Precisio 2. Is it easier to use than the Precisio 1? Because we all know that the Precisio 1, acquiring cases, can be really time-consuming and difficult.
Well, I would like Giulio, but also Claude, they can provide they are using since, especially Giulio, since quite a lot, and I think that he is the right person to answer.
No, really, the automatic acquisition is very fast. It is not so difficult for the patient to do it, and for the nurse or for the optometrist too. Until a few months ago, the must what I wanted to improve was the fast of the elaboration of the data. But now, with the new release, the data are elaborated faster, because now take about 20 seconds, I think, for the elaboration of the data of the map. No, Giuseppe is right.
You are totally right. And Giulio, let me add a news that it's just a brain news. I mean, actually, thanks to all of the complex cases that we got from Giulio, but also from Leopoldo Spadea. Leopoldo Spadea took a very large amount of complex cases, and this allowed us to further optimize the auto acquisition. So basically, Giulio, also you will see, and also we will provide you basically the 6.0 version of the software of Precisio 2, which basically I would say that in 99% of all of the cases in the automatic acquisition works in a perfect way. I think that you will really appreciate this new introduction that we will shortly provide you. I mean, for sure, before the end of the summer.
I just might add, it is actually much faster, it is much more reliable, but still there are some issues we're currently working out. So it's a clear improvement, it's good, not perfect yet.
Yeah.
Thank you, Claude. I mean, this gives us always the hint to improve, but I will be very, very glad to to provide both to you, Giulio, and to all of
yes, you. As you know, Giuseppe, we have some difficulty with the anthropometric measure. So guys very with the head very short, with the prominent face, or with the orbital difference for the normal. In some cases, the acquisition is not too easy.
Okay, so let's go now again as discussed with the iris laser. Please, can you take the connection by the iris laser? Actually, what you will see here on the central left is basically, we will show the ablation on the black paper because basically on a test object, you will not see the sides of the spot. So we prefer to show the ablation the way that basically you will clearly see the how beauty is the spot, how little is the spot and how it works. So you see on this, phantom test, we will have the black paper, and this is again just to show you the quality of the spot. Actually, you will see that basically we will introduce this disposable kit, and this disposable kit basically go completely the seal. You will see that once the disposable kit is introduced, then the arm will go down. And the silicone part after the centration of the treatment, and the silicone part will just protect basically the eye from touching from the from the arm coming down. You see on the top, I mean, the image is not very clear because the connection is very good, but on the top right, you see the ablation profile. Actually, what we are looking is the stromal profile. I'm sure you remember this was the stromal profile of the treatment of the post-transplantation. You see that now the optical path is completely sealed. Of course, the eye is not at all touched. I mean, so the airflow is fully controlled. So now we may start the surgery. And look at how delicate is the spot. Unfortunately, we cannot have you the capability to listen, but believe me if I tell you that you will barely be able to distinguish the impact of the laser spot because it's very, very basically tiny. The connection is not extremely good, so you cannot perceive, but you may see now the sides of the spot. Erasmo, we cannot improve the connection in order to show it better, right?
No, unfortunately, no.
Okay, but here you see the size of the spot and you see how now the speed is increasing and you see how it perfectly matches with the profile with an extreme accurate way. Once again, the spot here is well below, less than half of our iris one, as well less below of any hour of competitor. So now this is basically the executed ablation for this patient. While let's go now and also make the cross-linking treatment. So they will show, excuse me, let's make the ablation for the ectasia. So we will show them how the cross-linking works, the customized cross-linking. I'm sure you remember this is the map. This bean egg will be the ablation that we will execute for the patient. And immediately after, we will switch the channel in the laser. We will now, of course, introduce again the single-use disposable in order to heal the optical path. And actually, we will execute the ablation. Again, please look at how delicate is the shape reconstruction with IRES2. The treatment time always is, as you know, thanks to the capability. You see now we are working now in the periphery for the epithelial removal. And of course, here still the treatment time take well below than 60 seconds. But once again, I want you to look at the quality of the beam, which is, I mean, I'm really enthusiastic of the quality that we can get right now with this such of beam. Very, 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 very little beam. Now let's go to the second step and make the cross-linking. So we are now going to remove the single use, switch from 193 to 365. And this, I'm sure you remember, is the customized, basically, ablation. Actually, we will execute it on a yellow paper, which is sensible to the 365, to show you how the, basically, how the cross-linking beam will contract, basically, during the execution of the customization. So if you're ready, please, let's start with this. So basically, as you may see, the treatment starts with the largest diameter, but also, as you may see, we have an offset. The offset is exactly the offset which was delivered by SIFTA to IRES. And then it automatically reduces, again, according to exactly the cross-linking map. Of course, here you may understand that the eye tracker is of a fundamental importance because we need, as we do for SIPTA, we need to track the treatment on real time. Well, I would like now to just go back for a moment. Can we go back to SIPTA to see now if the customized treatment for Francesco Ragni are already executed? And as you see here, basically, we already, actually, with the setting that you pre-selected, we already basically have the plan which is already executed. And actually, for this case, the setting that we selected here was anterior subjective correction, meaning that we are not considering the posterior, and total subjective correction. Actually, let's look at the difference in between these two. I do not expect to find big differences because this is a quite regular case, but we will see. Well, as you see, I mean, there is a slight minor difference in between the two ablations, and this is more relevant to basically the minor contribution of the posterior, but it's almost quite constant. So as you see here, basically the plan was already executed by the SIPTA in the web, while you were acquiring another one patient or making a phone call or whatever you need to do. And of course, if you want to change anything, you can go in edit and basically make any change you wish, change the optical zone, change the photopic pupil, change basically the refraction, change the customizer to standard plane, whatever you want, you may change, and then the machine will automatically compute again the calculation. Is there any question you would like to ask us, my friends?
We have in chat a suggestion from Professor Kaufman.
I will. I don't see in the chat. I see.
I was just suggesting that maybe in the new SIPTA you introduce a feature like a mouse over. You know, I'm impressed with all these new abbreviations, ECTRARTC.
So
apparently we have to completely relearn about tomography. it might be helpful, especially in the beginning, if you know when you move the arrow over a certain area, then it just you have a box popping up that just shows you the full name and maybe a short definition of what this is all about.
You are totally right, Claude. As you know, we will basically now deliver you, there will be a tooltip where there will be a clear explanation of each function. But what we will do in this phase is that we will be glad to share basically a demo version with whoever is interested to evaluate it, to get any comment suggestion before basically, as you know, our interest to match as much as we can your needs. So please, I mean, any comment, any suggestion, and of course, any criticism. Even more, I would say that the criticism are more appreciated because, as always, they help us in order to improve. So, I mean...
Are you have a question, if possible? Please?
Is it possible to customize our personal settings?
So, absolutely, yes. Erasmo, can we show how to go and here? Those are the SIPTA settings. Let's go on a point, my point for a moment. Please, Erasmo, go to global, first of all. Here, look, Giulio, you customize, first of all, if you say, I want to show the advanced data, or I don't want to see them. Actually, basically, you may say, I don't want to deal with, for example, axial length or FK or FR, and I want just to have second order correction. And then in such a case, you go there, show Erasmo, please, in show detail. And you can just say, just standard data, okay? To simplify and to make more, less data your video. You may say, basically, I want to use, maybe that in some cases for some complex patient, you may say that the posterior shape is not completely validated. So you may say, do you want to, in case the posterior basically is not validated, and when validated, we mean, again, is up to 3 microns, so very strong. You may say, I don't want to use posterior maps. If what the machine does in such a case, Giulio, if the posterior is not validated and you selected total corneal remodeling, it automatically will switch the treatment to anterior corneal remodeling because you just say to the device, if not validated, I don't want to take care of the posterior. On the contrary, if you say, as it is right now, use not validated, the machine will calculate the TCR, but you will have a pop-up that will tell you, look, my friend, it was not completely validated. You want to completely trust it? And this, of course, is at the end your choice. Go now on basically the settings. Here, basically, you may set up to 4 different plans. And for each plan, let's see, for example, the TSC plan. Here you may say, I want to basically use the photopic pupil of P-matrix, or I want to use a standard photopic pupil, okay? In such a case, you should say, if you want standard, which one? You may say, and this is the most important feature on SIPTA, my friend. You know that always now, we always try to basically, when there is an issue on the connecting zone that it's too steep, or an issue that we remove too much micron, you know that you are all familiar, my friend, on SIPTA 1, that we reduce in a progressive way the ideal zone until it matches with our requirement. The bright new of SIPTA is that if you put preselected, you see P matrix auto-limited by connecting zone, it means that the machine, if basically ablation is to depth according to the finite element analysis that we perform, or if the connecting zone is too rigid, it will automatically slow down the ideal pupil size till to the limit to grant the stability of the treatment. So you have not to waste time basically reducing in a progressive wave the ideal pupil, because this will be, this it is done automatically by precision. And this is a very, very, very nice feature. Of course, I mean, there is still the possibility to make data extrapolation. you may define basically your refraction, if you put refraction on the vertex or on the cornea. You may decide basically which connecting zone, how to deal with the connecting zone. For example, you know, I told you that SIPTA2 provides a constant gradient. How much is the constant gradient? Well, we came out with a nice 25 diopter per millimeter, but of course, if you want, you may change. There is still the additional offset that you may change. And in the technique, you may say, of course, do please a standard epithelium or a customized epithelium, and do a debridement border up to 9 millimeter or to whatever, or just go circular, or just stop wherever you wish. This you may do for each single kind of treatment, and you may say, please list up to 4 different treatments to be automatically planned. So you have the possibility, of course, to customize these, but as well also the cross-linking you customize. For example, okay, you may customize all of the treatment. But this, again, this will be discussed. Whoever of you would like to have, again, this virtual, actually we are very late, but whoever of you would like to have this introspective virtual visit on SIPTA2, just send us an email and we will organize for you a dedicated demo on SIPTA2. Any further question or any comment or any suggestion?
Giuseppe?
Yes?
I have one question. At some point I have noticed you have a total ray tracing corneal power, and then you have total eye ray tracing power. So there is a distinguish between the two, right?
Good. Very good. Very good question, Alex. Very good question, as always. I mean, you know, I mean, Alex, the reason why, go for example, in one of these maps, go in the ray tracing for this guy. Look, my friend, if we look at the total cornea, actually, basically, the total cornea here, if we look, let's look, for example, an axial map here, Erasmus. Look, those are the numbers that we are familiar. It seems like this cornea is a power of over 50 diopter. But Alex, as you know, this is totally not true. I mean, those are basically virtual representation with all the axial and tangential maps. The real power of the cornea, and we know that, I mean, it cannot be the cornea, just the cornea cannot have a power of 42. Vice versa, the axial length of the eye would not have been 22 millimeters. So the ray tracing provides us the effective power of the cornea. So in order to understand how then the total power can increase, then we introduced the ray tracing up to basically the, including the lens, up to the retinal plane. So now if we go here on total eye, actually, we are looking to basically the expected contribute of our lens. How do we calculate it, Alex? As I told you, we do allow the introduction of that biometric data, which allow actually to define exactly where the retina is located, but also where the anterior and posterior lens are located. Mm-hmm. Then, basically, thanks to the Gullstrand eye model, we know that for each basically axial length, there is a predefined definition of which one is the profile of the lens. And actually, due to the lack of knowledge that we have on the real lens profile, we use, in order to estimate basically the contribution of the lens, the profile of the lens, which is basically derived by basically the Gullstrand formula. And this is really helpful. I mean, Alex, we did actually with Gianni several cases and also with Cosimo, several cases of planning using the biometric data. And I will show you, curious to say, that it is of a very helpful contribute to basically look at the contribute of the total cornea in order, especially on the keratoconus, to validate the spherical component. And we found that in several cases, this is much better than make an estimation, which is completely, basically, you know, unrealistic, especially, you know, better than me, than how our eye tends to compensate the cylindric correction with the chromatic compensation. So I would like to say that there are two reasons for this introduction of the total eye, and this is, of course, just for ray tracing. One is to show that it's only thanks to the lens that we can raise up the power in the range of 41, 42. And second is to use basically the total ray tracing in the family of treatment that we call, Erasmo, can you show the families here, the IA and the in EA, please. So basically, when we deal in a complex case, if you introduce the biometric data, as you see, the software automatically switched. This was done, for example, as I told you before, for the treatment of these, you know, transplantation. You see here, the software, due to the reason that we introduced the exact biometric data for this patient, switched the treatment from ETCR to AITCR, means that axial length is included, is dominant with the refraction, with respect to the refraction selected by the operator. Of course, you may either compare the simple ITCR with the AITCR in order to select which one you will consider to fit better. But believe me, it's a very powerful tool to support you in the decision. I don't know if my answer was
perfect. So it allows integration of biometric data.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Did you think one step further? Then we don't need to subjective refraction. If we have biometric data and corneal data, and then just
absolutely, Alex. This will came out. You know, the soft. We have all of the tool here, but in order, but you know, Alex, that I always like to rely on what I can prove. And now there is no basically possibility to prove, to get good repeatability on the acquisition of the anterior and posterior lens profile. That's the reason that basically we still need to have this basically evaluation, but you are totally right. Absolutely, in our patent on the ray tracing on SIPTA, we exactly say that at the time we will be in the condition to clearly identify the profile of the lens as we identify the profile of the cornea, you are totally right. You don't need subjective correction, absolutely.
Great.
Well, I mean, I want to thank you for being so patient and spending so much time together with us. Just let us know if you wish to organize this dedicated SIPTA demo. And in case, I mean, you have any specific interest, I don't know if you want to look, for example, to the possibility to make the first order correction for macular degeneration, or as Ars was asking, to see the multifocal approach, or again, this function to consider the biometric data. Any question you have, please just deliver it to us and we will be very glad to organize a dedicated session for you. Okay, so if there is no further question, I want to thank you for all of your time and see you soon, and hopefully see you on the next year in person.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you, Giuseppe, bye-bye.
Hello to all of you. Hello. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye. Thank you. Thank you.
Bye, thank you, bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.